Good morning and welcome to worship here at Brentwood Baptist Church. We are delighted that you chose to be with us here this morning. You know, the Lord invites us into His presence because of what His Son, Jesus Christ, has done on our behalf. This morning, we will be doing a responsive reading. The initial reading will be done from the platform by one of our leaders, and then we would invite you to respond with the congregational reading.
We are gathered here together in the same room at the same time to make as much of God as possible while we carry one another's burdens and celebrate one another's joys.
Accomplish your purposes among us, O God.
We are gathered here because we believe that we are called together into a work we cannot yet know the fullness of.
Still, we trust the voice of the one who has called us.
And so we offer to you, O God, these things, our dreams, our plans, our vision, our moments and our gifts. Shape them as you will.
May they be invested toward bright eternal ends.
Shepherd us well, lest we grow enamored of our own accomplishment or entrenched in old habit. Instead, let us listen for your voice, our hearts ever open to the quiet beckonings of your Spirit.
O God, lead us in your love to those around us.
You alone, O God, by your gracious and life-giving Spirit, have power to knit our imperfect hearts, our weaknesses, our strengths, our stories, and our gifts one to another.
Unite your people and multiply our meager offerings, O Lord, that all might resound to your glory.
In these moments, we are reminded and reassured that He who has been faithful will continue to be faithful.
O Spirit of God, now shape our hearts. O Spirit of God, now guide our hands. O Spirit of God, now build your kingdom among us. Amen.
Church family, may I invite you to stand and hear the word of the Lord from Lamentations 3. Because of the Lord's faithful love, we do not perish, for His mercies never end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Amen. Let's sing that together, this timeless hymn.
There is no shadow of turning. But you, dear friends, as you build yourselves up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting expectantly for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ for eternal life.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, sing this one. In this
worthy of all the praise. seated. So many of us know this hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. The story behind it, Thomas wrote this hymn. He became a Christian at 26. He was born in a log cabin in Franklin, Kentucky. Became a Christian at 26. Went into the ministry at age 36. And then retired after 1 year of service because of poor health. And then he went back to New Jersey and became and stayed as an insurance agent at a desk job. And he wrote 1,200 poems. And one of these poems was this. Maybe this morning, church family, you needed that reminder that he is faithful. Maybe it's a season of the mundane or a season of trial and darkness. Maybe you sweetly be reminded that God is faithful even when we're faithless. It doesn't rest on what we're doing, but on who he is. Amen. And so we're going to take these next few moments in silence, one-on-one with the Lord. I'm going to guide us through a prayer from Lamentations 3 and give some promptings. But let this time just be between you and the Lord. If you feel like this, if you want to come up on these down front steps, please do make this your altar or come where you're seated and stay there and just pray to the Lord. So let's take a few moments and pray. Good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. Is there someone you're praying for to receive salvation? Test and examine our ways and return to the Lord. Let us lift up our hearts and hands to God in heaven. Take this moment to just confess to the Lord in areas you've been faithless this week, but yet praise him for his faithfulness in your life, that he pursues and loves you in the midst. I called on your name, O Lord, from the depths of the pit. You heard my plea. Do not close your ear to my cry for help. You came near when I called on you. and you said, do not fear. What are those fears in your life? And will you push fear out with faith? And in closing, Lord, we pray, remember our affliction and our wanderings. Our soul continually remembers it and is bowed down within us. And this we call to mind, and therefore we have hope. The steadfast love of yours never ceases. Your mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, including this morning. Great is your faithfulness. May our heart's cry be, you are a portion, and therefore we will hope in you. Amen.
Cheese à la side, bon appétit. She came to our church about 2 years ago. She was saved, so we started the discipleship process, and today she comes to testify her faith in Jesus Christ. Arasai, ¿es verdad que tú has recibido a Jesús como tu Señor y Salvador?
Jesus is my Savior.
Amen. Por tu profesión de fe, mi hija, yo te bautizo ahora como mi hermana en Cristo, en el nombre del Padre, del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo. This is the Morillo family. They came to our church 2 years ago. They become saved. We started the discipleship process. They took discover us, discover you, and now they are here to testify their faith in Jesus Christ. Nicole, ¿es verdad que tú has recibido a Jesucristo como tu Señor y Salvador? Amén. Hija, yo te bautizo ahora como mi hermana en Cristo, en el nombre del Padre, del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo. Amada, ¿es verdad que tú has recibido a Jesucristo como tu Señor y Salvador?
Sí, Jesús es mi Salvador.
Amén. Amada, yo ahora te bautizo como mi hermana en Cristo, en el nombre del Padre, del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo. Daniel, ¿es verdad que tú has recibido a Jesucristo como tu Señor y Salvador?
Yes, Jesus is my Savior.
Amen. Daniel, yo ahora te bautizo como mi hermano en Cristo, en el nombre del Padre, del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo.
Well, as we finish celebrating the wonderful stories of life change through baptism, we also want to look forward to the life-changing stories that will come from our time together with Mount Zion on August 3rd. just around the corner from us, there are families experiencing a very different kind of life that many of us in this room may never truly be able to understand. Unless we've personally experienced food insecurity, sometimes it's hard to understand the day-to-day struggles families face living in poverty. So in an effort to engage the whole person with the whole gospel of Jesus Christ, we will be partnering together with Mount Zion to host Better Together for the third year in a row. Our two churches will partner together to provide our neighbors with a hot meal, free healthcare screenings, and backpacks full of school supplies. Things that they might not have regular access to, despite living right here next to us in Middle Tennessee. But it's about more than backpacks. It is also about building relationships that open the door for gospel conversations. It's about intertwining cultures to reconcile the racial divides and regain a unified community for the gospel, just as Ephesians 4 shows us in Scripture. But we know that we cannot do this alone. It is because of you, your faithful participation, and your faithful giving that we are able to meet the basic needs of our neighboring communities and begin building gospel-centered relationships. So as the ushers come forward, let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your mercy, for your grace, and for your compassion. We confess to you, Lord, that we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. So help us, God, to walk together in faithful obedience. Amen.
They tell you just keep playing till I got here. It's a pretty good church when Dick Tunney is your backup. Thanks for being here, Dick. Sunday night, July 21st. Sunday night, July 28th, 5 o'clock. We're going to have an open forum, family discussion about some of the things that we're finding out about the realities of some of the changes that are going on in the 37027 zip code, the mission field of this congregation, and I want you to be there. One of the things that we have found out is with all the starting of campuses and that kind of stuff, we haven't had the opportunity to sit down and talk as a church family, as this congregation. So we've scheduled two nights. They'll be the same. I'm going to spend about the first 20 minutes talking about some of the changes that we're finding out in our research, some of the things we're finding out about our new community, and as well as the reach of our church, and some of the things that we think we're going to have to change in order to be on mission in this area. So that's both the both the same, so pick one that works for you. 5 o'clock, I'm not going to feed you. That way we won't be here all night. I'm hoping at least you'll get hungry and then we'll be able to go. So it's 5 o'clock, and bring your questions and your points and all of that, and we'll put them out, and we'll talk about some of the real opportunities that are ahead for our church, as well as some of the challenges. With my ADD, you can imagine the number of notes I took home from teachers who said, "Mike is a good student, but he talks too much. Mike is a good student, but he won't pay attention." It wasn't that I wasn't paying attention. I just wasn't paying attention to what they wanted me to pay attention to. I was always paying attention to something. And one, if I knew where you were going, if I knew how the story was going to end, I wasn't going to pay attention. If I'd already heard what you were telling me, I wasn't going to pay attention. And whoa, if you put my desk next to a window, I was good for the whole day. I can't tell you the number of times my mom and dad, my professors, my teachers, my wife, they said, "Mike, pay attention. Pay attention." And now I've lived long enough to be in a culture that celebrates ADD. We call it multitasking, which is ADD with a computer, which means you're never where you are. If you're meeting with a colleague, you're not actually meeting with a colleague because you're answering emails. If you're at home, you're not actually at home because you're responding to text. You're never where you say you are, never doing what you say you are doing because, well, you are multitasking, ADD with a computer. Our world thrives on distracting us from those things that matter. There's always a new YouTube video. There's always an email or a text to keep you preoccupied for those things that ultimately count. And you and I, as Christ followers, have been placed in this culture to tell them, pay attention. There are things that matter. Ezekiel had this call. He tells us about it in the 33rd chapter of his book. Stand with me in honor of God's word. The word of the Lord came to me. "Son of man, speak to your people and tell them, suppose I bring the sword against the land, and the people in that land select a man among them, appointing him as their watchman. And suppose he sees the sword coming against the land and blows his trumpet to warn the people. Then if anyone hears the sound of the trumpet but ignores the warning, and the sword comes and takes him away, his death will be his own fault. Since he heard the sound of the trumpet but ignored it, nor the warning, his death is his own fault. If he had taken the warning, he would have saved his life. However, suppose the watchman sees the sword coming but doesn't blow the trumpet so that the people aren't warned, and the sword comes and takes away their lives. They have been taken away because of their own iniquity. But I will hold the watchman accountable for their blood. As for you, son of man, I have made you a watchman for the house of Israel. When you hear a word from my mouth and you give them a warning from me, if I say to the wicked, 'Wicked one, you will surely die,' but you do not speak out to warn him about his way, the wicked person will die for his iniquity, but I will hold you responsible for his blood. If you warn a wicked person to turn from his way and he doesn't turn from it, he will die for his iniquity, but you would have rescued yourself. Now as for you, son of man, say this to the house of Israel. You have said, 'Our transgressions and our sins are heavy on us. We're wasting away because of them. How can we survive?' Tell them, 'As I live, this is the declaration of the Lord God. I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked person, but rather I would want that this wicked person should turn from his way and live. Repent, repent of your evil ways. Why will you die, O house of Israel? As for you, son of man, I have made you a watchman over the house of Israel." This is God's word for God's people. Hear it, believe it, and live. Let's pray together. Help us know your truth. Help us speak your truth with boldness and conviction so those who need to hear it will turn before it is too late. And we pray this in your name. Amen. In the South, if you say that you're going into the ministry, people assume that you are called to preach. And they will talk about your calling to preach. They'll never talk about your calling to pastor. They'll talk about your call to preach. And as soon as you start talking about it, they will refer you to this passage. And so you hear about this and you spend a lot of time reading it because it's the way that the church wants the pastor to understand the great burden and weight that comes with standing up here and telling you, this is what the Lord says to us and this is how we have to respond. And that if I shy away from that responsibility, the responsibility and the consequences of that choice fall on me. So you spend a lot of time reading this passage. You spend a lot of time pondering it, dealing with it. You spend a lot of time in the book of Ezekiel. And if you do, you'll find out that the book of Ezekiel is broken down into about three rough sections. The first section is a warning to Jerusalem and Judah that if they do not turn around, God will punish them for their wickedness. That punishment takes the form of the Babylonian exile. And we think that Ezekiel, like Daniel, was one of those people who was first carried away sometime around 594, 593 BC. We know from Daniel a lot about this Babylonian captivity, and Babylon had a way of once they took over a nation, once they conquered a nation, they would take the best and brightest of that nation and they would take them back to Babylon and they would train them to be officers in the Babylonian government. Daniel was one of those people. We assume Ezekiel was as well. So the first part of Ezekiel's book is a warning to Jerusalem, a warning to Judah. The exile comes. The second part is a warning to the other nations of the world, especially Babylon and especially Egypt. Assyria had left the stage of history. Babylon had now stepped up. And Babylon and Egypt were the two main world powers of this time. Babylon to the north, Egypt to the south, Jerusalem was right in the middle of where these two major powers were having their conflict. And so Jerusalem was caught in the middle of this conflict between Egypt and Babylon. So Ezekiel warns the king of Babylon, don't think you're all of that because God has used you as an instrument to punish his people. You may think that you're king of the world. You're not. You're on the throne because it is God's will and you are his instrument to punish his people. Remember what Jesus said to Pilate? When Pilate said, don't you understand I have the power of life and death over you? And Jesus said, you have no power except what my Father in heaven has given to you. One of the unique things of Scripture is that God uses unbelievers, pagan kings, Roman emperors, to carry out his will. He uses whoever he wants to accomplish his ultimate and divine purposes. Now, some of us have this weak view of God that if we don't do our part, that God will somehow not be able to do his. Let me help you understand this. When Jesus returns and finishes his work, there's not going to be one part, one aspect, one dimension of it where Jesus will say, I almost got that right. Everything will be completed according to his divine will. Now, who he has to use to get to that part, that place, is a matter of how we respond. And I know some of us are thinking, hey, if I'm not there, then Jesus is not going to get it done. And as if Jesus is going to stand up and say, you know, I could have done so much more if Mike had been on my team. Let me break this down for you, Alabama style. One monkey don't stop no show. And it is God's will that you and I participate with him. It is God's will that you and I be part of his divine purposes and divine plan. But if we're not, don't think he's going to end up short when it's all said and done. Don't think his divine purposes won't happen because we're not part of it. So God is using whoever he wants to, and now he is using the king of Babylon to inflict his judgment on his people. The third section is a statement of salvation and hope. God will restore Jerusalem. God will restore Judah. God will restore the throne of David. God keeps his promises to us even when we don't keep our promises to him. God is faithful to us even when we are not faithful to him. Now, when you look at this passage, there are three real key points I want to be sure you see. One, notice when the watchman is set on the wall, notice who Ezekiel is to watch for. We always assume that the watchman is looking for bad guys, but look who it is that is coming. Point number one, God is coming. It is God who is coming, not anybody else. It is God who is showing up. Throughout Scripture, we have these promises, we have these miracles and celebrations where nothing will separate God from his people. Nothing. Not our sin, not Egyptian slavery, not a Philippine a jail in Philippi, not death itself. Nothing will separate us from the love of God that we have in Christ Jesus. And he's not going to let anything separate you from him. He's coming. He's always coming. Now, for some of us, that is good news because we have been praying. Life has been hard. We have been caught in some prison we can't get out of. We've been dealing with some obstacle we can't get over. And now we hear God is coming and he will bring redemption and health and healing and freedom and liberty and will release us to our ministry and to our purpose. For others of us, it is not good news. Here's the second point. God is coming, and he's coming with salvation or judgment. Now, we all have this misunderstanding about God's judgment. And whenever you see God's judgment portrayed, there's always something blowing up, right? Mountains blow up, lightning from the sky, on and on it goes. It's great theater. It is a great movie, but it's not the way it's taught in Scripture. God's judgment in Scripture is he lets you go. If that's what you want, he lets you go. Now, you think God's going to zap you with a lightning bolt? He won't. He'll just let you have the consequences of the choices you've made. Hey, you got the corner office. It's what you wanted. You're successful. You gave your life for it. You gave your family for it too. But it's what you wanted. It's what you got. You moved to Nashville, brought your guitar. You wanted to be famous, now you are. And now you don't know who loves the star and who loves you. You can't trust anybody. Hey, it's what you wanted. It's what you got. You thought the problem in your marriage was her. What would make you happy, what would fix your life is another woman. It's what you wanted. It's what you got. You see, the hell of hell is that we choose it. When I was teaching Kairos, people would come to me, young adults would sit down and they would tell me about a situation. They would look at me and go, I don't know how I got here. And we would start talking about their life and decisions they had made. And we would talk about this decision. And the decision that made that decision, and the choice that made this decision, and the decision that led here. And moment after moment, step after step, choice after choice, we found out how they got exactly where they were. The joke of Kairos, I-40 goes to Memphis. You get on I-40 West, leave Nashville, I-40 West, you're going to Memphis. You may feel like you're going somewhere else. You may be celebrating how good a time you're making, but you're going to blow Memphis wide open. What's your clue? Big signs. Memphis, 100 miles. If you get on I-40 West, don't be surprised that you ended up in Memphis. And when you choose to be disobedient, when you choose to be self-centered, when you choose to desire what you want, at the cost and sake of everything else, don't be surprised when you end up right where you are. How many of you were alive in 1985? I was old enough to read in 1985. That tells you how old I am. And one of the books we read in 1985 is a wonderful book by Neil Postman called Amusing Ourselves to Death. And Neil Postman is writing as a cultural critic about the danger of television and what it was doing to the way that we know truth, experience truth, and how easy it is for television to warp truth and misrepresent truth. He was so dead on in what he said that a lot of us who know this book are watching everything that we're finding out in social media and what social media is doing to us. And we're going, wait a minute, we've heard about this. Yeah, it's in Postman's book. Let me give you one of the quotes that come out of this book. A lot of us were afraid of Orwell's 1984. You remember that book, 1984? All animals are equal, just some animals are more equal than other animals. And pigs could talk and all of that. And so it was a great book. But he says it was not Orwell that got it right, but Huxley, Adolf Huxley, in his book, Brave New World. Here's the quote. Huxley's vision, no big brother, is required to deprive people of their autonomy, maturity, or history. As he saw it, people will come to love their oppression, right? Nothing sells in our culture now like victimhood. All right, I'm oppressed, okay? Come to love their oppression. Not the oppressor, but we will love the oppression, to adore the technologies that undo their capacity to think. To adore the technologies that undo their capacity to think. You want to set off a little panic? Stand up at the beginning of the worship service and say, turn your cell phones off. I can hear you. What if somebody texts me? Who more important than God is going to text you in the next hour? But there may be a new cat video. And I won't have seen it. Now we're finding out that this little gadget is always listening. And so when you say to some friends, you know, I really like Corvette Stingrays. Everything in your ad will be about Corvette Stingrays. Now, how do they know that? All right, Jacqueline Swinsky, my administrative assistant, my executive assistant, is a big Kentucky fan. For her birthday, I got her a Kentucky hoodie. The internet doesn't know I'm an Alabama fan. It thinks I'm a Kentucky fan. Every day, all day long, I get reminders that Big Blue is on sale. I don't care. Call me next year when it's Jacqueline's birthday again. I'll do another hoodie. Every day now deprives us of our ability to think. So that you no longer know what really matters. Last point. Point three. How God comes is up to us. If he comes bringing salvation, or if he comes bringing judgment, that's up to us. And you and I know this. We know where these roads go. We know what they will do to people's lives. Do you ever turn to your workout partner and ask them, are you on the road to where you want to go? Do you catch your neighbor in your driveway and ask them, do you know where this road goes? I have appointed you as a watchman. You and I know where these roads go. So I'm waving my hands as big as I can, saying it the best way I know how, as loudly as I can. Do you want to go where the road you're on is taking you? Because the road you're on is going somewhere. Make sure it's where you want to go. Let's pray together. Get your heads bowed and your eyes closed. I'm not going to do anything to put you on the spot. But I don't want you to misunderstand how serious this moment is. What's at stake? What's at risk? Some of you right now are saying, well, I did this and I didn't get zapped by lightning. I think I got away with it. No, you didn't. Don't confuse God's mercy with weakness. Don't assume because he hasn't done something to this point that he won't do something. That you won't be trapped in the consequences of your own decisions. But this morning you can change that. Christ himself has come to you with healing and life in his hands. Now I know I'm saying a whole lot, just a handful of words, but our pastors, our counselors are already standing out at a table. Says next steps. You can't miss it. They want to continue this conversation. Just go and say, hey, I want to know more about what Mike was talking about. Or I've got some questions. They'll pick it up from there. I promise you, they're waiting for you now. Perhaps it's to come be part of this church fellowship. You come. We'd love for you to join our family. Or maybe it's a time of repentance. However the Lord has come to you, he's waiting for you where you are right now. The church will wait for you as you come. Lord Jesus, every life is now open, every heart. So we pray the choices we make now are exactly what you want.
I want to give you time to continue to respond to the word that we've just heard and give you time to make a decision that you need to today. Let the words of this song pastor you through these next few moments.
Thank you.
go in grace and peace to love and serve the Lord.